All right, that one boy, let me get the other one here. All right, I'm set, Jerry. All right. This is a series of talks on the astrological aspects. And that's very concentrated. And the reason for the concentration is the importance of the aspects in practical astrology. Of the four major factors in astrology, the signs, the houses, the planets, and the aspects, the last two are the most important, the planets and the aspects, and especially the aspects are important. When we started, we began looking at the aspects as static geometric figures. We did that from the viewpoint of a kind of spiritual geometry, even though we didn't go into it very deeply. And then we looked at a lot of classic examples of each of the aspects using horoscopes, using the planets that rule the aspect in the aspect itself. Now this year we have started looking at them dynamically. And we are looking at the aspects as demarcations or turning points within an ongoing cycle. And the first thing we did with that is we looked at it in theory and we got an abstract idea of each of the aspects within a cycle. Now we're doing it with examples. And we're using examples from the lunation cycle, which is the cycle between the sun and the moon that we see every month. And we're looking at people who have aspects at each of those. Last time we met, we looked at sun-moon conjunctions. The first or separating conjunction, or the constructive conjunction, and the last or the applying conjunction, which is destructive. Now this time we're looking at the sextiles. Yes, sir.
Just talk away a little bit and see what it moves.
Yeah. It's not, is it?
It's not moving. It wasn't moving while you were talking there, other than getting one.
Can you push it up higher? Okay. There now? No.
Yeah.
All right.
I'll watch it for a moment.
All right. I'm getting weaker with age. And we'll have to figure out this whole business with this microphone. All right. This time we're looking at the sextiles. And in doing this, we're saying the same thing applies, that there are two of every kind of aspect, two sextiles, one in each half of the cycle, in the beginning half and in the second half. We're calling those that occur in the first half of the cycle, we're calling them first aspects or constructive aspects. And then the second half, they are called destructive, though in some ways for some of the aspects, deconstructive would be better. In any binary cycle, it always begins with the conjunction, and it continues till the opposition. In the lunation cycle, the first sextile occurs about 4 days and 16 hours after the new moon, which is about more or less 4 2/3 day after the exact new moon. Now, there are several ways that we can look at the first sextile, and we'll look at only a few of them as we will with the second sextile. Now, we're going to look at horoscopes that I've looked at before, the same horoscopes I've looked at before, but I completely redid everything and looked much more deeply and comprehensively at the horoscopes so that I could do better with it. Now, one key word for the first sextile is it is the beginner's luck sextile. It's sort of when somebody has little experience but a lot of enthusiasm and a lot of confidence. And those qualities produce a relaxed attitude. I used to have beginner's luck with pool in my old days hanging around the bars. What would happen is I'd take a few drinks and I would not be so neurotically tense as I normally was. And then I could play pool like nobody's business. This still wasn't great pool, but for me, I was astounded at how well I could do. And I don't think the astoundment was from the drugs. With beginner's luck, you don't expect a lot of depth or comprehensiveness. And that's one of the things. Those words describe Judy Canova. I guess nobody in the room knows Judy Canova. Maybe Jerry does. You remember Judy Canova, Jerry?
From what?
From the radio days and early television?
No, I think she was from Pikes Peak, was still
in. This is a person, you can't say that she didn't have any talent because she was a decent singer and yodeler and guitarist. And she had a family band with her brother and sister in Florida. And she was sort of a likable goofball. And she made everybody laugh. Sagittarius is rising, and the sun is in Sagittarius, and Mercury is in Sagittarius, so you can see that this is somebody that's light-spirited. Jupiter, which rules the ascendant, is in Aries, and it is a mutual reception trine between Jupiter and Mars, which is in the first house. And that shows that not only was she happy and cheery, she was pretty boisterous, vigorously happy and cheery. So she stood out in this hick band that she and her family had. And they had such success that they went and played a club in New York that specialized in country music. This was way before the big country music thing really took off. And she was so impressive that she was put on a radio show that was run by Rudy Valley, who was the star of the time. Our parents' generation liked Rudy Valley. And this led to her having her own radio show. And it led to supporting roles in movies, and eventually she made three of her own movies. They were all B movies, but she played along with the hillbilly shtick, and it really was that, because the title of one of her movies was called Joan of Ozark. So she was a hillbilly, but there are no hills in Florida. The highest elevation, I think, in Florida is 450 feet. I couldn't believe it when I saw it on a map one time. Bascom Hill, if we could transport it to Florida, would be the highest elevation. So it was her relaxation and her sense of fun that allowed herself to go into the sense of silliness. And that sense of silliness, she gave her the first facility. She was able to entertain, and she just let things flow. The sun is also trine to Neptune, and it's drawing from Neptune, so you might say that she had the sense or the spirit of silliness. And so she flowed not only into acceptance, she flowed into great wealth, because the first sextile was beginner's luck, it was nouveau riche. She became you know, wealthy really quickly. Now, even though it isn't easy with beginner's luck, even if you have beginner's luck to make it big time, she had plenty of ripe destiny. That's what all those planets in the 12th house mean. And plenty of ripe destiny, it was her life to collect. It was sort of like this was her pull on the jackpot, and she was cashing in on destiny, and that first sextile was that. It didn't take a whole lot for it to produce success for her. Now, this is one of those charts that is difficult, because she may not be one of those people that is what you see is what you get, because half the planets are in the 4th, the 8th, and the 12th houses, and those are things that are hidden. And so there were a lot of things that were hidden, and most of them were positive, but they did occupy her. You might even say that one of the functions of the beginner's luck sextile was to draw her out of seclusion. Now, there's something in this horoscope that is fascinating, because it's not only a horoscope for sextile. There is a conservation of the soul in the horoscope. Now, Mars in the first house shows that she was probably, especially that trine, the mutual reception trine to Jupiter, showed she was probably more of a tomboy. She was not a glamorous sex pot. But she's probably not completely happy with that, because Venus is in Scorpio, and she would have liked to perhaps have had more of a sexual life. But Venus squares the moon, and she wasn't happy. As a tomboy, she never really adjusted and got happy with herself as a woman. And Venus also is in a T-square with Saturn and Neptune, which shows something highly depressive. So this is the horoscope of somebody that is manic outwardly and femininely depressive, sad about how much she was a woman and things like that. So, love and emotionality are two different things. It's clear she can love, because Venus is trine to Pluto, and she can love, and she can love really strongly. But she had an enormous sexuality problem, insecurity. She had four marriages, and only one child out of one of them. And none of the marriages lasted long. So it was beginner's luck, but she was not able to loosen herself up completely emotionally. Yes, sir?
In your reading, did you see who she might have co-starred with or anything like that?
No, it was all B people. She never really made it big time that way. She did guest on, when television came in, she did guest on a lot of television shows. She was one of those quaint curiosities that come, you know. All right. Sometimes doing astrological work is difficult, because sometimes it is given to you to help people, and they are people that you don't really like. Nonetheless, it is rewarding sometimes, and sometimes it's more rewarding than with the people you like. The next horoscope, I don't like the person behind the horoscope, and I don't dislike him because of his philosophy and his political views. I find him very hard to take because of his attitude, the way he is with himself. And this is the horoscope of Rush Limbaugh. This is a very accurate horoscope. The astrologer who registered it had the newspaper clipping of the small town newspaper on the day that he was born, and it even gave the time of birth in the newspaper clipping. Yeah, that's good data when you get that. It's called the double A chart. Venus is in Aquarius near the ascendant, and it's trine to Saturn. And that teaches us a lesson, because normally with that, you would expect someone who is tactful, somebody who's subtle, and somebody who's debonair. And instead, we get Rush, who's blustering all over the place. The lesson is that we can choose which parts of our horoscope we want to respond to. We, you know, if we can change ourselves, that means we have choice about what things we have built into our character to use. He chooses to use the second planet in the first house, which is Mars, and Mars is opposite Pluto. Mars is in Aquarius, and what it is he works himself into a frenzy and anger on purpose. And he's a bully. Mars in affliction with Pluto is somebody that can be a bully. And he's everything that his detractors accuse him of. Your enemies often can read you better than you read yourself. He's a fake. Sun square Neptune, he's a fake, F-A-K-E. He isn't what he appears to be. He's a drug addict with Sun square Neptune, and he's a man with secret perversions, which we won't go into because the things that are said about him are really terrible things. And he's delusional about himself. He's an extreme, those are all things from the Sun square Neptune. Then he's an extreme liar. He's got the classic liar's aspect. Where is it here now? Mercury is in a very strong aspect with Neptune, with Saturn, a square, less than 1 degree. So he's almost a compulsive liar. And he's a cunning liar. That's a symbol of cunning. But he's also tremendously successful. And he's also a 12th house son like Judy Canova, but the 12th house is probably different for him. The 12th house is the opportunity to be in touch with what Carl Jung calls the collective unconsciousness. He touches on that. He has the ability to feel the psychic pulse of the nation. But because the sensitivity from some Neptune is negative, he touches on the negative feelings of society. And what he does is then he pours them out. He has that first facility of being able to put them into words and to really get upset, and people want, you know, everybody would like to really be angry. There are a lot of people that like to shoot the TV, and they never do. And they really like it when somebody can bluster like that. So that's what Rush does. And he's very good at that first facility of getting it out. And it's also made him rich.
Question.
Yes.
Mercury opposite
Uranus.
Does that make his lies more outrageous?
It means that they're probably crackpot lies. That's a crackpot aspect. It's not standard political philosophy of a conservative type. It's kind of, you know, he always seizes some little thing. The Saturn Mercury part of it is he seizes some little detail. And he just runs with it for weeks and weeks. He doesn't believe in global warming because there's one glacier that isn't melting really fast. And so he says that one glacier proves it. And he'll go on and he'll run that thing on his show for weeks. Now, politicians like to say, we're going to keep this all positive. But they find out it doesn't work. they get more response from voters by being negative, by either saying bad things or playing on fear. And if they do both of them, they really succeed. And if you listen, I don't listen to them often, maybe once or twice a month or something like that, and then only for a few minutes. And it's very rare that you ever hear him say anything positive. Even about Republicans, sometimes he doesn't have positive things to say. Now, sometimes beginner's luck is not due to relaxation, and it's not due to realizing how difficult and complicated things are. Sometimes beginner's luck is a matter of circumstance, and it is to be the right person at the right time in the right place. And the next horoscope is probably such a person. This is the horoscope of Wilt the Stilt Chamberlain, who was one of the first really big men. He did amazing feats, but they weren't necessarily due to skill. They were due to size. He was a very big man. I'm wondering whether the batteries are going down, huh? No.
It's all right so far.
Okay. He wasn't intelligent. Abdul Jabbar, who was probably the center of that era, said that Wilt Chamberlain and Shaquille O'Neal were both stupid meatheads. And they didn't really know anything about the game, which is probably true. My friend Eddie and I like to watch basketball games, and we almost want to turn them off every time Shaquille O'Neal is on. He wasn't a team player either. He was an egoist. He was, give me the ball. You would have to be not a team player. This is the first person to score 100 points in the game. Obviously, his teammates fed him the ball again and again and again so we could score 100 points. He had some skill, but he wasn't Bill Russell. Bill Russell was his greatest competitor in his day, and he was considerably shorter, but he was able to handle them. So his facility isn't really what we'd call facility. It was a matter of staying at home. He has that son in the fourth house. This is a strange way to put it, but he didn't move around. He just stayed put around the basket, and they fed him the ball, and he dunked it in. And it is because of him that they had to widen the foul lane. They intentionally changed the rules of the game so that he had to, at least part of the time, be further away from the basket. Now, there's something interesting in here that he also took advantage. It's a little bit off theme. He claims to have copulated with 20,000 women. And he described that most of these women were so beautiful that most men would propose to them on the first date. You can see that he is a bit of an egoist. The person who helped him calculate it claimed that during his sexual active period from age 15 until about the time that he was retiring from basketball, that would mean that he would have made love to 1.3 women per day. And the man who did the calculation for it all said that he was being very conservative, and it may very well have been more than 20,000 women. This is common with athletes, but very few go for it. It wasn't a matter of passion. Mars is in Leo, which is a little bit pugnacious, and it's square Uranus, which is aggressive, but that really isn't a passion quality. But if you look, Venus conjoins Neptune, and they square Jupiter. And the Venus square Jupiter indicates that it was an indulgence. Sort of the way somebody can sit down and eat an entire box of chocolates, you get indulged. And when you get into that and Neptune is involved, there's a kind of delirium. And so he was deliriously sexually indulgent. So I don't know what to say. Venus is in Virgo, which is an earth sign, and is a sign that is subject to sexual addiction and too much sex. All right. Now you can look at the first sextile as a budding talent. And sometimes things bud and they don't continue to mature and to develop into something greater or something deeper or anything like that. If you look back at your own life, the kids that were popular in junior high don't continue to be popular in high school and in college and in adult life. They copy from that famous statement by Richard Nixon when he lost to Kennedy. He said, "I peaked too soon." And sometimes the first sextile is that. It's someone who peaks too soon and in doing so does not allow themselves a chance to mature into something better. In fact, they have a very difficult time becoming much of anything. This is just such a person. Brittany Spear, I had trouble with the printer, that's why it's cocked. She knows how to communicate. She's got the sun and three other planets in the third house, and she knows how to communicate light, shallow, happy things and to be positive. And she can pour that into the fifth house. That's the way she synthesizes. She has a communicative skill that she parlays into an expressive skill. And expression is something where you pour yourself into it and you give yourself to it. Now, she's not necessarily a wizard or a magician or anything like that, but neither was Judy Canova. Now, Sagittarius does indulge, but Mars is trying to Venus in here, so she really does have a passion. And that passion also translates into what she does, because the people that she appealed to were people who were undergoing all the hormones of that age. So, with the Mars square Neptune, not only did she have passion, she was probably boy crazy. Mars represents young men, and now she's an adult, she's probably man crazy. And she has that sort of thing. She's, sleeps around a bit. Now, this is going to be like going from the swamps to the mountaintops. In the horoscopes we've looked at so far, we've seen mostly people who are at a young stage or cycle of development. They're having the first blush of success. And they appeal to others that are of the same way. In the case of Britney Spears, we saw that there was some talent with that, and she was in that young stage. The first sextile doesn't always have to mean that. It can mean the ability to down-tune in a broad, sextile, simple way for beginners. It is the mark of a very advanced individual to be able to speak to the deep people and to be able to speak to children. And to do that, you have to state something in a simple but not simplistic way. And sometimes it's a sacrifice to do that when you would rather be doing something deeper. And that describes the next horoscope. So we'll look at several of those kind of horoscopes next. It's the horoscope of Tenzin Gyatso, the 14th Dalai Lama, yes. This is somebody who is deep. Sun trine Saturn, no doubt about the depth. It is somebody who is broad, because the sun trines Jupiter. And to complete the grand trine, Saturn trines Jupiter, it's somebody that has very good judgment. This is somebody who has mystical ability and occult ability, because Neptune, in the synthetic sextile with the moon sextile the sun, sextiles both sun and Jupiter. So he has the capacity. Destiny doesn't make mistakes, at least not big ones. So we have to assume that for destiny there was some reason for Buddhism to be rousted out of Tibet. What that reason was, I can't say for certain. But one of the effects of it was, is that it is brought more into the Western world. And that certainly meant something more new for the Western world, something young and fresh, but it also did for Buddhism. The sun is in the first house, and that it's in Cancer, and it shows him to have a homey but august presence. The first sextile is between the first house and unusually the fourth house. And this probably indicates that, it's hard saying. It seems to mean that his outward presence and facility is not obvious. It seems like a lot of it is beneath the surface. To a large extent, he's trying to speak to individual subconsciousness of various people in his audience. What he is doing is bringing Buddhism to the general public. He's capable of doing deeper things, but being a spokesperson, and he's an excellent spokesperson with Mercury in the ascendant in the first house, he's speaking to broad general audiences. And in order to do that, he has to simplify. And in simplification, he is applying the first sextile in a positive, useful way. The moon and Neptune are opposite Saturn in the 10th house. And that indicates that the mantle of politics and always being at the forefront of society is a heavy mantle for him. And it's probably a great sacrifice. He would probably prefer retirement, but he feels he has to compromise. This is what it is when you have duties. You have to make great compromises. Now, from what we've just said, one is tempted to say that the first sextile could be called a simplicity sextile. And that is true, but it's not the only kind of simplicity, and it requires clarification. the purest form of simplicity comes from the trine, because in the trine things are perfected so much that nothing unnecessary is done. The simplicity of the first sextile is like elementary simplicity, like the simplicity of writing primers for little children. You start them with very simple things. Now, the next horoscope is the horoscope of somebody who is capable of very vast and deep understanding, but who chose to express simply. Horoscope of Ralph Waldo Emerson. Again, it's a little odd because of the printer. He was a Unitarian minister. He was a marvelous essayist. He has a book called 5-Minute Essays that is just beautiful. And he was supposedly every bit as good as a speaker. Now, he was friends with Samuel Taylor Coleridge and William Wordsworth and the other luminaries of his time. And he was conversant with transcendental philosophy, both Eastern and Western. But that isn't what he did. He began working from nature. And he was conservative. Conservative not in the way that we use the word today, in that he tried to conserve the beauty and the wisdom that was found in nature and carry that through to the human spirit, so that his transcendentalism was based on the kinds of experiences that we had here and the obvious beauty of it all. The first sextile in this case includes Mars. The sun is giving to the moon and it is giving to Mars, which that indicates like a really, not only something that's at an early stage, but it's a vigorous, fresh, it's even got a little bite to it. And it's just what you'd expect for the United States at that time, because we were a young nation. And you expect something youthful. You wouldn't expect something like Goethe's Faust coming out of United States in the 18th century. So, it's a simplicity, but it's a simplicity that with its simplicity, it has vigor. It's like by keeping it simple, he could make strong statements. And everybody has favorite Emerson quotes. I have two of them, which I think are just beautiful. One of them, he said, "A sick man is a sinner found out." And the other one, which I like even more, is, "What you are, speak so loudly I can't hear what you say."
Oh, you said that.
Yes, he was the one that said that. All right, so all of this could apply to all of his work. He keeps that same vigor, that same youthfulness, and keeps it accessible, because the early people of early United States were simple people. They didn't have time to ponder and go to college and things like that. So this is a very good way of using this first sextile.
As I look at that chart, just the pattern, it just seems like it's so balanced. It's
yes.
Yeah,
there. He had. We can look at some of those things. He had the sun trine Uranus, which indicates that he was very inventive, and he brought out a lot of things. There's even more vigor from the Uranus sextile to Mars. However, he did have to struggle to keep alive, and he really wasn't really close with his children, which is the sun square Pluto. So there are all kinds of things in there. And I think that the first sextile was successful because There is a tendency, especially for Gemini people, for people to talk too much and say too much. And he has Mercury square to Jupiter, and the same Mercury square Jupiter I have, only in different signs. And he did not talk too much, so he was successful in keeping the interest and the vigor by keeping it simple. Now, sometimes first simplicity is both good and questionable at the same time. And that's what happens with the next horoscope. The next horoscope is for the first person to graduate from medical school in Italy. And she did it with one of the highest records. She was in the brilliancy category. This is Maria Montessori. She's famous for having developed a system of education. She was a very dedicated doctor when she was a doctor, and she had a hobby. This is kind of a strange hobby. It maybe is like a Saturn in the fifth house kind of hobby. But she had a hobby of going to insane asylums. And she was fascinated by insane people. And there were a lot of young people, children even, in the insane asylums. And she thought it would be a wonderful thing if they could be educated rather than to be in asylums and treated like animals. And so she tried to do that. And she had success. And some of the people that she had success with were children of famous and powerful people. And she was urged to start a school. And she did. And she had some remarkable success in that school and became world famous. Now, the key to her success was in the first sextile between the sun and the moon. She put her attention fourth house-wise into the subjective observation of each student. And she adjusted the education according to what she saw in her observation. And so that if you went to her school, it seemed like chaos, because there would be children of several different ages, and each of them would be doing different things that she had thought were subjectively important to each of them. As a result of her observation, she noted periods that children are more educatable and sometimes more creative. Unfortunately, she published them, and then it became canon. And when that happened, it was no longer based on observation, it was based on Maria Montessori says. And the interesting thing is that periods, educatable periods that she had, were not coordinated with physiological periods of development. Neither were they coordinated with spiritual development, which is kind of strange because she was a theosophist and she spent many years in Adyar, India, at the headquarters of the Theosophical Society. So she did her own thing. And so the sun rules the ascendant, and the first sextile is from Virgo into Scorpio. So her educational system, because of the Virgo emphasis, became manifest on the senses and sensory materials. And she thought that since this is where we live, that's where all the emphasis or the majority of the emphasis should be placed. And when she saw the children were educatable, she saw they were educatable to this world. And so when a child entered a teachable age and it was, she could find that from observation, the child was not encouraged. It was even gone so far as to be pushed. And it's not good to force things on a child, because of the much better if you go at the rate that the spiritual innards are developing. And so it produced remarkable results, and it still does. There's a Montessori school three blocks from here in education. But it's education to this world, and it doesn't necessarily produce spiritually healthy results. Yeah, that is in adults. And so this is an example of the first sextile having positive and negative qualities, and the negative quality being being peremptory. And a lot of this seems to be because of bad judgment. The relationship to fifth house is relationship to children is the fifth house, and Saturn is there opposite Jupiter. And as far as I can see, she didn't really exercise great judgment at all. No, I think it probably has more to do with a strange notion of Saturn is in the fifth house, which indicates hobbies, and it's trine to Neptune, and she got positive insights and deeper understandings and a spiritual outlook through dealing with people who were insane. All right, now let's turn to the second sextile. And when we do that, we find something like simplicity, but of a much different variety. In order to understand that and get the feel of the second sextile in abstract, let's look at where it occurs in the cycle. It occurs after the second square and before the second conjunction. Now, at the second square, the underlying structure of the work that is being done in the cycle has been withdrawn. It can no longer be sustained. So it is broken down to get as much as you can out of the cycle, because if you hang on to the structure, you wouldn't get everything out of it. At the second conjunction, everything dissolves back into chaos to be recycled. So the structure has been removed, but it's not quite yet into chaos. And so one way we can understand it is to understand that it has been simplified to the elements, and the structure isn't there any longer. That's all you need is the elements. In the first sextile, you could say that's elementary, like elementary education. The second sextile reflects on the elements. It isn't just a destructive breakup. It is reflective, as the moon is reflective, because this is in the lunar half of the cycle. So if we look at it in terms of deconstruction, which is different than destruction, at this stage we can see many or all of the principal constructions as well as the elements. So we have the principles and the elements. And then in consciousness, not in fact or in outer reality, we can put things together reflectively from the same constituents. It's like looking at a pile of bricks after the building has been taken down and seeing in your mind how other buildings could be built from the same bricks. Now, there's a term for inward rebuilding after things have been broken down to their elements, and it is called synthesis. So this is called a synthetic sextile. It is a creative process from existing basic materials and experience with those materials without necessarily materially manifesting them again. There are other ways to look at the second sextile, but this is a good way to begin. Most of our consciousness is concrete. Even the abstract experience that we have relies on concrete things to be understood. Geometry, all of mathematics for that matter, is a good example. Now, there are abstract manipulations in our consciousness in proving a theorem, but we rely on the visual or concrete figures to get to those abstract manipulations because we can't do it completely in abstract. So mathematicians often have excellent concrete minds as well as abstract minds. And some of them are so concrete that they focus only on the concretions and the geometrical figures or planes or whatever they're working with as though they are the realities. So sometimes there's the good combination of both the abstract and concrete, and the next horoscope is the example of that. It's the horoscope of a mathematician and logician who is famous for things other than mathematics at which he was most accomplished.
Oh.
Yeah. Now this is an excellent example of concentration of the concrete mind. Saturn is trine to Mercury. It's a nice strong trine, and again, it is a mutual reception trine, which makes it even stronger. Saturn is the concretizer, and in concrete earthy signs, it is abstracting out of concretions. Just the thing we're looking for. The moon is in Sagittarius and it's in close conjunction to the ascendant. And the moon forms a second sextile with the sun. Now, Sagittarius and Aquarius, the signs of the sun and the moon, are the signs most inclined to abstraction. Both of these planets are anchored by a strong will, indicated by the trine and sextile respectively to Pluto. So they can hold that there together. And that is excellent for synthesis. Now, there's no astrological connection between these two patterns, the Saturn-Mercury and the Sun-Moon patterns. But it's still there because it's all one person. That's one thing that you have to learn with astrology. Even if there aren't astrological connections, it's still one person. And there are things that are in that one person. And when you manifest one part of your character, it affects the other part. So you could say that there was no direct connection between the extreme jocularity of Judy Canova and the depressiveness, but there is. You can only go so far without producing the opposite extreme. There's that conservation there that is there. We can see this connection from psychology. In depth psychology, there is a phenomenon that is called condensation. Condensation occurs when different symbols are concentrated and fused together to give an abstract idea. So if you have a strange kind of thing, like if you have, a dog coming out of the side of somebody's body in a dream, that has meaning. In mythology, when different ideas are condensed together, like the Sphinx, It is a psychological condensation. So condensation is both a concentration and a synthesis, because you're concentrating things together, but in creative consciousness, you synthesize something new out of them. Now, Lewis Carroll is famous for that. He made all kinds of condensations into forms of neologisms, and they were all condensations.
What's neologisms?
A neologism is a new word. It's not usually complimentary, but in his case it is. The most famous example from him is the word chortle, which is a combination of a snort and a chuckle. And he did a lot of that. So the synthesis of Lewis Carroll is not only intellectual, it is productive in other ways. He takes elements from his immediate environment, which is what it means having all those planets in the first house. And he condenses them, or he synthesizes them into products. He objectifies them, and he makes them clear in his writings. Now, the lurid question everybody wants to know is, was Lewis Carroll a pedophile? Certainly, he loved children passionately, because he has Mars and Venus in Sagittarius, and Mars rules the house of children, and the first house is going back to your own child, and he had a passionate love of children. They form a benign aspect with Jupiter. They form a sextile. So it was probably a philosophical love as well. Now, in the psychology or the etiology of the development of pedophilia, one of the things is lost innocence. And usually the innocence is lost in a past life. I've had conversations with a man who was a Jesuit. And he tells me that in Jesuit circles, that the term Jesuit is almost synonymous with pedophilia. And this man was himself a pedophile, but he never acted on it. He was a Jesuit, and he was a Jesuit priest, but he had desires for little children. And he worked them out in a kind of a form of punishment of himself. He would go to sun dances and he would rip skin off of his body the way the Native Americans did. And that solved two things. It was sort of like a penance to him for having those kinds of thoughts, but it also was allowed him to balance the sophistication of his Jesuit education with a primitive kind of consciousness. And if you know anything about the history of the Order of Jesus, they took a vow to do anything to serve the order. And they're famous for lying. The doctrine of equivocation was a Jesuit doctrine. And they were hated, especially by the Protestants. And they would go to one king and they'd make a deal with him and say that the Pope will give you in war with, they go into England, for example, that was the most famous case. They went to the King of England and said, give me so much money and the Pope will give you preference. And then they went to France and said, well, England's willing to give me this much money. If you give me more, the Pope will give you preference. And then they would go to Rome with the higher total, and then they would tell the King of England, we had an intervening revelation. It was called, but at any rate, they would lie, and they would even murder if they had to for the sake of the order, which means they gave up innocence. So they're reborn in the next life. They had a statement, once a Jesuit, always a Jesuit. And so they're reborn in the next life. And because of having taken that oath, I don't think it'll last eternally, but it lasted into the next life, and they're born as Jesuits with no sense of innocence, and they try to recapture innocence through children. And because they can't handle their vows of poverty, because they've never been trained to do so, pedophilia runs rampant. So if we look at this horoscope, we don't find anything. He was a man of the world, but there's nothing in here to indicate lost innocence. If anything, he still has the innocence. So it's very unlikely that even though he loved Alice, who became the Alice in Wonderland and took all those nude pictures of her and things like that, it's unlikely that he was a pedophile. Lost innocence would probably involve something very ugly with Saturn and Uranus. Uranus is that new budding innocence, and Saturn would be the harsh old way of business is business, and we do things like that. I'll try, if I sometimes can do it, I'll try to find a... that was called lost sleep. All right. And just as an interesting aside, that this is a good example of a bucket horoscope. All of the planets except Saturn are pretty close to being within 90 degrees. And Saturn is the handle of the bucket. And it means that he's the first quadrant, which is where the majority of the bucket is, all but one planet, indicates that he had some personal activities to take care of, and it all depended on that concentration, and all depended on that kind of ability to focus. All right. Sometimes synthesis is not grounded, and it's not objectified when the synthesis occurs. Lewis Carroll is a very good example. When that is true, the synthesis can be the stuff that dreams are made of. Synthesis must at least be made somewhat manifest, if not objectified to be proven. Otherwise, it's pie in the sky. Our abstract consciousness and even our concrete minds to some extent are not developed so that we can think true to material reality, or that we can think true altogether. And unless we manifest things and prove them out, we're likely to make great errors and think that we've done something that we really haven't done. I've had all kinds of great ideas that turned out to be nothing but fool's cap. And that happens that way. But that doesn't keep us from believing that they're true. And the next horoscope is the horoscope of somebody who believed that his synthesis was true. Horoscope of Jean-Jacques Rousseau, which everybody is really eager to to delve into. He wrote a very famous biography called The Confessions, which was really in some ways bragging and exhibitionism. I read it, I learned a lot from it, but I didn't learn what he was wanting me to learn or to take as fact. Bertrand Russell, the great British philosopher, read it and he said, "It was written with slavish disrespect for the truth," which is probably the case. Nonetheless, he was a good writer. He got Virgo rising, and the ruler of the ascendant is in the other mercurial sign, Gemini, and it conjoins Mars and Venus. Shows that he could write clearly, he could write persuasively, and he could put some oomph behind it. They sextile Saturn, so he could focus that. So his writing is fascinating, and he writes about fascinating things. Boy, I learned a lot about corporal punishment from him, because when he was a young man, he was subject to a lot of that. In his biography, he braggingly makes a synthesis that has happened to almost every astrology, every philosophy student that I've known of. In his biography, he brags that he could synthesize all of the philosophies from history because he understood them and they were so clear to him, and that he could dispel all of the apparent contradictions. He could synthetically unify them. Now, there's no doubt with that, with the moon conjunct Neptune in the ninth house, which is the house of philosophy, that he had intuitive hits, and that they formed long lasting images and impressions, because they're in Taurus and they're with in the sextile to the moon, which is also visual. So he had all of these visual images, and so he really did have intuitive experiences. But the intuition and the consequence of the intuition are not the same thing. Our personalities are not clear enough that we can follow all the intuition all the way into its complete manifestation in our psychology. Intuitions always have to be interpreted or put into use. And if we have screwed up psychologies, we misinterpret what the intuitions mean. His emotions were exaggerated and they were overblown because the moon and Neptune also square Jupiter. So he blew things out of proportion and had that positive feeling that I know something when he really didn't know it. So his intuitions became excited emotions. Now, in order to synthesize, you have to work with the elements, which he didn't do. He never did. He said he could do this, but he never looked at any of the contradictions between these philosophies, and he never did do any of that synthesis. He felt he could do it, and that was enough. That was sort of the end of it. So he had the feeling of truth and opinions. Now, he did synthesize about other things. He synthesized into the 10th house. He had synthesized all of his ideas into ideas about government and society. And he believed in bonhomie, that he believed that men were basically good, and it wasn't quite laissez-faire, but that if we didn't have all these complicated intellectual philosophies, that people would be all right on their own. And so he manifested these things, these syntheses, but they turn out to be quite a bit emotional mush. But the thing of it is, with the Neptune moon again, which we've seen in other horoscopes this evening, he was in touch. And he was in touch with France, and the people of France had the same kind of opinions and emotional mush. And so he did manifest things. He did objectify some things. He objectified the synthetic sextile, not only into ideas about government and things like that, he objectified them into the general destiny of society, which is where Pluto and Uranus come in. And he is one of the three people, Diderot, and I forget who the third one was, that were most responsible for provoking the French Revolution and everything that came after it. But everything that came out of his writings in terms of revolution, it certainly wasn't pretty when it came to the days of the guillotine and all of that, and then was followed up by Napoleon. Not quite the synthesis that one expects. Now, if you put two and two together, you get four. And if you put two and two together enough times, you get a million. And that's what our next guest did. It's the horoscope of Walt Disney. His horoscope is not important for building the media empire, which was sort of incidental to his life. His life is important, especially to us astrologically, because of the multiple syntheses. Every time there was a new major technical development, he was aware of it. And he brought it into the world. And he found ways that he could influence people with it. So the moon is in the first house, and he knows what's going on in the environment. And then it gets synthesized to the sun and Uranus, which is a love of technical things and an understanding of what you could do with technical things. So he would see things in the world, and he would find ways to use them to communicate. Now, if you look at what Walt Disney said, you read Cinderella, or you look at the movie Cinderella, or Goofy, or stuff like that, the things that he had to say were not deep things. They weren't deep things at all. His synthesis was more in taking things that people believed in and giving them into a way that they felt reinforcement and they felt entertained. He was way ahead of Marshall McLuhan because he knew the medium is the message. Because, you know, people were fascinated what he did by cartoons, and then they did things with television, and then with theme parks and things like that. It was all, you know. So people, it was the time of the Depression when he started with all of this, and people needed to relieve their woes. He was sort of a Mr. Clean in his philosophy. He was a real Sagittarius, Mr. Nice Guy. People got fired if they cursed in the studio or anything like that. And he was still trying to bring those simple, positive Sagittarian ideas to the people that they would feel good about them. Now, the moon also squares the planets in the fourth house. And he had a very hard time. His home life when he was a child was very poor, extremely poor. And I think it was something like he said to himself, I'm never going to let this happen to me again. It was that kind of a square consciousness. You know, this, I don't want this. And all of his synthesis is trying to stave off the kind of panic and the kind of fear that he had in his subconscious from early childhood. So he was constantly trying to, things would come up to him and he'd find things in the world and he'd synthesize them in anything to do to keep away from what had happened to him that way.
And he's successful. He's still waiting to be unfrozen.
Oh, he is a frozen, huh? Wow, what a shame. Just think that he can't return those things to the elements, and he's hung here in the world. Ooh. Now, if you look, the Sun Uranus are in that opposition with Pluto, and that marked the beginning of the kickoff of the left half of the cycle. It was under that opposition that the Russian Revolution was formed. But nonetheless, he represents the last of the last of the old conservative values. Again, it's a different kind of conservatism than we run into today. Because he was struggling with innovation and using innovation to try and keep the past alive in his conservative values, he had compulsions. And he washed his hands 40 times a day. And even when he was treated for severe lung cancer and having lungs removed and things like that, he still smoked. And he smoked until it did him in.
And the compulsions are shown by what?
The Pluto opposite the Sun and Uranus. It's not accepting the changeover from the old to the new and not liberalizing something that was reactionary. All right. Now, there are almost infinite possibilities for synthesis. Sometimes if we break a building into bricks and in our mind construct something new with them, it's almost impossible to recognize the original building from which you got the materials and the ideas. Synthesis can be so abstract that one cannot see the relationship to the original. And this is the horoscope that is of that nature. Horoscope of Béla Bartók. Like many composers of his generation, he started out writing tone poems, but gradually he moved more and more into writing what is called euphemistically 20th century music. It's the kind of music that most people don't even consider music. The sun is in Aquarius. The moon is in Aquarius, which in him was his love of folk music. Before he could even talk, his mother would play Hungarian folk tunes, and he could tap on the floor or whatever it is. Before he could talk, he could tap out the rhythm patterns before he could talk. The Cancer indicates interest in folk music and other folk things, but it's usually the clannish sort of thing, you know, like when you have web feet and you're among the folk. I can't pass up a line sometimes. And with the moon, which rules Cancer, being in Aquarius, he has both tendencies. The Aquarian, which is a more ethnological interest in folk things, and it's more cosmopolitan. Now, there's a strong applying synthetic sextile between the 9th and the 11th houses. Now, Sagittarius and Aquarius, we said earlier, are the most abstract signs, and the corresponding houses, the 9th and the 11th, give the most universalizing opportunities. In other words, he had the opportunity to stretch synthesis as far as it could go. Often with his creative consciousness, he began with simple Slavic folk tunes, and the people danced to them, and he was inspired by them. But when he was done with them, he produced the kind of music that you need a special musical education and a very good ear to even recognize that they're there. Harmonies were turned into melodies and things like that. Now, Aaron Copland took folk music also, like Appalachian Springtime, for example. When you look at when you listen to Appalachian Springtime, you can still hear the folk themes. You don't hear that with Bartók, they're gone. It's just an abstract synthesis of them. The Aries qualities are such that he was always pushing things to the new frontier. I don't think it was competitive, but it may have been, because all of those composers tried to get further and further out. And it's not like he didn't have an aesthetic sense, a very delicate one. Venus conjoins Neptune, which is a very good aesthetic. And it's not that he couldn't communicate those delicate things, because Venus and Neptune sextile Mercury. So he had the ability, if he wanted to do that. But those delicate things were so synthesized and abstracted and experimental that, wow, he just lost it. And the Mercury-Uranus part of it is that he would bring in new notions, almost gimmicky notions, and it may produce something very, very strange. I like the music, but it isn't easy to learn, and it isn't easy to come to like. I think his six string quartets are beautiful, absolutely beautiful, but if I were to play them now, everybody would want to leave the room almost immediately. He just wanted to synthesize. And sometimes it was without good judgment, because this is another horoscope where we have Saturn-Jupiter problems, and it was not a good case of good judgment. For example, he wrote, fifth house is personal expression, and the 11th house is impersonal expression. And so his creations, his synthetic creations, were impersonal. And he had two famous ballets, but it took at least 20 years before anybody would put them on. One was called Bluebeard's Castle, and it dealt with all kinds of forbidden no-no subjects. And the other one was called The Miraculous Mandarin, and it took a long time for that to be put on because it dealt with prostitution and murder and things like that. Not the normal fare of people running around on stage with tutus.
No, the fact that Sun though is in Aries, that would make that music also something quite personal, would it not?
Harsh. To him it was spirited, and to him it wasn't violent. It was an impersonal violence. If you can take somebody being murdered because he's trying to pick up a prostitute and put it into a ballet, it's pretty impersonal. And that's what he did in The Miraculous Mandarin. Now there's something in this that is important to us as astrological students. There is a class of astrologers, and you find them in not so much Mountain Astrologer, but you find them in publications by astrologers for astrologers. And they do the same thing to astrology. They have mathematical and other techniques of synthesizing astrology so that you don't recognize a horoscope anymore, and you certainly can't use it to help people. And so it's something to be wary of and not let that happen to ourselves. All right. The last horoscope for the evening. Anais Nin. Everybody knows who she is? One of her favorite words that she slung around quite a bit was synthesis. She synthesized her whole life in some ways. She began as a Spanish dancer and was quite accomplished. And along the way, she became a Freudian psychoanalyst, in which she also became quite accomplished. But she's most famous for making art, or making an art form out of diary writing, which she did exquisitely, but not as exquisitely as she thought. She thought she was a major writer rather than somebody that was up there, but not really that great. She also wrote her diaries dishonestly. She kept several diaries. Some of them were true and some of them were lies. She has the same dishonesty aspect as combination. Rush had a square. She has the conjunction. She has some of the Moon-Neptune things like we have seen in other people this evening. She was an eroticist, and when she was broke, which means she was between husbands, she wrote a lot erotic literature for money, and she was exotic about it. Her most famous work is called The Delta of Venus, and I'll let your imagination tell you what that means. And she saw writing eroticism as an art form. She was very close friends with Henry Miller, and a psychoanalytic necessity. Now all of this is shown in the erotic part, the exotic erotic part is shown by Venus square Uranus. The emotional obsessiveness dealing with sex is shown by Venus square Pluto. By association, but not by orb, there is an opposition between Uranus and Pluto, and that shows a rebellion, both poles of rebellion, against all cultural standards. When she danced, she had magnificent control. Mars is trine Pluto, and that's the control aspect. She was in control of her body. I suppose that when she copulated, she had the same kind of control, but I don't really want to go there. It gave her an outlet. But when the dancing days were over, sex became her outlet. It's a Freudian idea. You have to use it in order to be psychologically healthy. She married very wealthy men, bankers. Like, for example, when she was married to her husband, Hugo, was a banker who let her do just about everything she wanted. She had an affair with Henry Miller. And at the same time, after many years, her father, who was sort of a womanizer himself, a philanderer, came back into her life and she seduced him. And she got pregnant, and it wasn't clear whether the child was from Hugo or Henry Miller or from her father. That's really quite a thing. She claimed it was Henry Miller, but it didn't make any difference. She aborted it anyway, like she did with several others. She kept true and false diaries. And she has the moon opposite Neptune. That synthetic moon has a lot of emotional confusion. She claimed that she lied when she talked to people and when she wrote. And she said she did it because people couldn't handle the truth. She probably couldn't handle the truth, and that's what the projection was, and she couldn't face things about herself. Even with Mars in the first house, you'd expect that she'd be brave, but there was enough of that woo-woo Pisces stuff in the chart with the moon, Neptune, and then the planets in Pisces. The synthesis is between the third house and the fifth house, which are the houses of communication and expression, just like Britney Spears. Hers was not an abstract synthesis like Bartok. And it was not a concrete synthesis like Walt Disney. It was a literary synthesis. It was like she was putting it down on paper, what if I had done this at this time, or done this at this time. So truth and dreams and lies and fantasies and ideas were all poured into this expression of herself. She was doing what Freud thought you should do. She was getting it out. Now, strangely enough, it worked. Not completely. She never really came to know herself. But in doing these things, she came to know herself somewhat. Because the sun is not only in the synthetic sextile with the moon, it's in trine to Neptune, which is excellent for psychological, spiritual self-knowledge. So in doing ifing, she came to know things. And I think that, I don't remember what the end of her life was like, but I suspect that at the end of her life, she was probably quite understanding about herself. And so, in those expressions, it was a valid synthesis. She paid a high price in order to learn that, and the price will probably carry into the future, but she at least came to know what she was all about.
Question.
Yes, sir.
The fact that it's in water, could that be considered kind of an emotional
thing? Oh, yes. This is all watery. Neptune is the king of the sea. The moon rules water, salt water, all the planets in watery sign. Yeah, this is completely emotional.
Which aspects show that she was
The almost exact trine between the Sun and Neptune. Sun-Neptune aspects are usually more psychological than spiritual. And this is a perfect example of using psychology to really know yourself. And that's it for tonight.
Richard, could you review the main statement on what the second sextile portrays?
It portrays when you have gotten ideas, it's the stage of a cycle when a structure has been broken down. And you have the parts or the elements or the stuff that the structure was made of. And when you're reflecting on what you understood while building and while breaking down, in your consciousness, you can synthesize other things. And that is the stage of the cycle. That is what the second sextile is like. Okay. Boy, I don't know.
Have you ever looked at sequential Dalai Lama's charts, or is that birth information not available?
I can't say that it's a heavily destined chart. I can't at all. Saturn is one planet that often indicates heavily destined charts, and it's in that grand trine showing age of soul, but I don't get the feeling that it's a heavy destiny. And I think that probably with his state of consciousness, you can't really look at the horoscope the way you do with other people, because with his state of consciousness, he has quite a bit of freedom as to how to work out the constituents of his chart. Okay.
Thank you.
Yeah, it was a fun night.
Yeah. Very good.
Mmm.